This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Back is sponsored by the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, Kale Bahamas Rev Trio, Fidelity Bank Bahamas, and CG Atlantic.
Got to get back. I need some get back. Payback. Payback. That is payback. Again.
Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to the Hit Back. I'm your host, Nahaja Black. It is a beautiful day here in the 242. Listen, man, I've had migraine. This must be migraine season. I've had a headache out of this world today. He said, Nahaja, why are you sharing this? Because who else am I going to talk to? Huh? My husband is tired of me saying, oh, my head. You guys are group therapy without any responses or facial expressions. You can't beat it. It's like free therapy session. You're my journal. Take it. I've had a headache all day, y'all. It's been like redonkulous, right? And it's affecting my sleep, right? So I'm thinking, what do you guys have as old, you know, like not old wives' tales, but like, you know, some sort of bush medicine I could drink to deal with this persistent bugger, you know? So anyways, just throw it out there. If you got a bush you want to tell me about, and please send a photo of the bush. I don't know nothing about bush. So if you send a photo and you tell me, okay, go outside down the road. And someone said that vaccine, you might be onto something. Well, let's say 4 days. 4 days. If at day four, I still got it, I need to go and give them a call, right? So if I still have a headache at day four, tomorrow, still got it by day four. And look, y'all could see I ain't sleeping right, right? So if I still have it by day four, I go and give them a call. But if you got something and that's like a bush thing, a majiggy, any sort of, you know, drink or whatnot, send me a photo, please, because I don't know nothing about bush. And don't, you know, don't tell me it got like three-pronged shape like a star or something. I don't talk bush. Sylvie always makes me feel good. Hello to everyone. Hello to my listeners in Exuma, Abaco, Long Island, Andras. Thank you guys so much. I appreciate all of you. And I appreciate all of y'all. And we could talk vaccine for sure, because we got, you know, there's a major push for this vaccine. And I tell you all, because of, you know, a personal work thing, I made sure that I took it, because we need to get some stuff done family-wise. Fingers crossed. Yeah, look at that, man. You can't see I ain't sleeping, y'all. Didn't even sleep last night. Life is different, eh? So we got a lot of stuff to talk about today. A lot of stuff to talk about today. And it's very important that we have these discussions, right? Because, so my mom calls me last night, everyone. My mom calls me last night. She says, why you made fun of them children, right? Well, you know, I had to explain to mom that the young people on the stage are not children. And she was talking about the youth debate and that the young people on the stage are not children. They were not children. We just happened to say youth, right? But they're young adults that were on stage. And she was all perplexed. Oh, why you do that, man? They just was trying. And I said, ah, Lord, here we go. Here we go. That mantra of they trying, right? And that spurred in me more from even yesterday. And that it is that the level of expectation, right? I remember when I used to do sports talk, there was this... There are two Bahamian athletes when I used to do sports talk, and I remember following both. One major superstar athlete, the other one, unfortunately, has found their career come to a complete halt. But that one was the shining star. That one was the one where they had shattered certain things and they were doing exceptionally well in their youth, right? And they were doing great things. Two Bahamian athletes. One has gone on to be next level. And the other one of course, due to injury and training and whatnot, has found that their career hasn't taken off to what the expectation was. And I remember people in the sports world talk, right? And they talk, and folks didn't like, the one whose career went off and took off, folks didn't like the coach. And they complained, well, that coach is just, you know, they try to protect the player too much. Or, but I mean, protect them. They always, you know, covering them. They don't allow them to do this, this, and this. And the other one, they never mentioned anything about the coach because they were doing well. And you, long story short, you started to get an understanding of what each, even in their family structure, what were the expectations. And it taught me such a wonderful lesson, right? It taught me such a wonderful life lesson. And the life lesson it taught me was expectations, right? And this is the example I'll give you. Because I can't go into the name of the athletes because I don't want to get there. Because, you know, they're Bahamian athletes. They're both doing well, but one exceptionally better than the other. The expectation game was a serious one to me because let's consider this. If you're a parent and you have a child that has struggled in school, right? You have a child that struggled in school. Your child has struggled in school. And so you set bars, right? So let's say your child is barely making a 2 point, if possible. And then they, you know, and then they're struggling, right? And children struggle. Some are not academic. Some are more technical. Some kids just struggle. They're not as academically astute. But that, I don't even blame that on the child. I think also we're only as smart as our teacher. Teachers have the capacity to change the way we learn. So a great teacher, we should reward every time you meet one. That is a kindred spirit, a soul, a saint. Love on a good teacher, please. Just as a, you know, service announcement. But expectations are a powerful thing, right? So when your child, if your child who struggles to make a 2 point, hits a 2.0, they're always a 1.5, 1.6, 1.7. One day they come home with a 2.0. What do? They've met a mark. They've met a mark you thought that they could not meet. What do? You get excited. You get super excited. And you're so proud that they hit a 2.0. And that may have been the mark that you wanted them to just hit the 2 point. But at that point, there is a relief and a release, right? A relief and a release. There is an exhale at this moment. We've achieved this goal that I thought was unattainable. They struggled. Oh, look at God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. A relief and a release. That relief and release sometimes gets parents or gets you in a position where this is good. I'm happy with this. I can live with this, right? I can live with this. What happens if you had a child who was always a high achiever and they come home with a grade that's below standard? So let's say you always had a child who was a 4.0 student. They come home with a 3.6. You know what happens to the child who's experienced higher? There's an expectation of that. You don't anticipate going lower. To others, that might seem like really good. To the parent whose child has a 2.0 average, they're like, but listen, what you complaining about? 3.6 is excellent. Don't beat the child up. That's a difference in expectation because you've seen the potential. You know the capacity, right? You've seen the capacity. Good coaches can see capacity. You may never have reached the goal, but you've seen the capacity and you build on it, right? You build on capacity. Expectation is about where do you see and what is your understanding of one's capacity. Ladies and gentlemen, I contend that we have a low expectation. So when folks exceed our low expectation, we have a moment of exhale, a relief and a release. Apparently, for some, young people showing up on a stage they've never been on to debate questions that they received early and in advance, that is commendable. That is, well, look, Matt, they tried, a relief and a release. The expectation of excellence, the expectation of position is a very important thing. It's like, you know, it's like a real real positioning. I want us to be able to, at this point, understand that your level of expectation is very important. How you view the world, how you view excellence will be how you receive it. We have had such low levels of expectation. We have such low level of expectations that when people show up, we consider that a big deal. When people fix the sidewalks, fix the roads, oh my God, look at them doing their job. Oh, they added a wing into the hospital, right? What is that it? I got people giving me some interesting suggestions. I can't wait to read them to y'all for my migraine. It's so crazy. And mind you, that's another side note. But on the expectation part, and I thought that was fascinating to me how folks were all up on, you got to give them credit. What? We've got people who are trying to run the country. These are young leaders. This ain't, youth in parliament. Let them run. Let them make noise. Now, we're going to dive into that a bit more, but there's something else that has come to my attention. Today, whilst I was getting ready for the show, whilst BPL was blacking stuff out, right? I got this message from a listener, someone who's listened to the show. We've spoken before, and unfortunately, they are in the hospital. The level of expectations already, though. They ended up in the hospital, and they sent me a text showing me photos, not of people's faces. They were very respectful, but of the space they were in. 14 people who have been admitted into Princess Margaret Hospital days ago are sitting in chairs today. No beds. Their vitals are being checked in a singular room in A&E that is holding them. This is like a holding space, an accident and emergency for 14 people that is happening right now. Actually, I think it should be down to 13 because one young lady who came in there, and these are not COVID patients. These are people who were tested negative, right? But they've been admitted into PMH for whatever issues ail them. I was told that one patient sitting next to the person or close to the person ended up having a seizure whilst they're in A&E waiting for a bed, waiting for anything. They're in chairs, wheelchairs, leaning back, laying over, moaning. One person had a seizure. It took about 5 minutes for the patients to get the attention of anyone. A nurse came in, then a doctor came in, but the patient that had the seizure, once remedied, is still sitting down, no bed. The person who reached out to me was admitted into PMH, not waiting to be seen, admitted as a patient from Tuesday morning, sitting 14 people. I don't even know who's first in the queue. 14 people, days upon end, waiting, right? And ladies and gentlemen, these are not COVID positive patients. These are people, I was told a young lady with a young lady with a knee issue, right? A swollen knee after days sitting, waiting for a bed. Discharge herself. This is a health, and I would dare say, crisis. You say, Nahaja, that's a big word. You know why? Somebody got to say it. Somebody got to say it, damn it, that we are failing in healthcare. 14 people. Doctors have been saying we need more staff. Nurses have been saying we need more help. Dwayne Sands, when he came in, was as much, we need more nurses. We were short staffed of nurses by hundreds. Doctors are saying we need more doctors. And I don't know if you guys remember the Minister of Education, one of his big announcements or pronouncements was that we don't need to send more young Bahamians off to school. Actually, it was the consultant physicians who begged to have the junior doctors, not just the consultants, sorry, it was the Union President Millicent Bassett, along with the consultant physician president, Sabriek Pinda Butler, asking that we get these junior doctors online. Staff, the hospital morale, I've been told by all persons, all sundry, said that staff morale is extremely low. People are burnt out. People are leaving. They are being poached by the private sector. This is important, ladies and gentlemen, because not everybody who goes into the hospital has COVID. We are a country filled with comorbidities. We're a country filled with people who have to go on dialysis, filled with people who have hypertension, diabetes, people with cancer, people who have broken limbs that need to be seen, but you're sitting. And I can tell you this. I know this is a fact because one of my family members, when they first appeared in the hospital with COVID, they came in and sat for hours crying in the chair in pain, right? Writhing in pain, chest pain, whatnot. And then were sent home only to be brought back via ambulance 2 days later. And it was told that my family was never supposed to have been sent home in the first place. So what is going on at the Princess Margaret Hospital? I was told that there's construction that has never been done. Construction that has been underway for years. We don't have enough nurses. We don't have enough doctors. There's no space to put people. And ladies, look, when we catch, y'all have to, listen, I've been trying to do the math. I have sitting on my desk the most recent budget expenditure, the 2020-2021 draft estimates of revenue and expenditure from for the government. And going through that, you try to really figure out how does money get spent in that calendar year. We're now in 2021, 2022, looking forward to what that budget debate is going to look like. Because ladies and gentlemen, billions, everybody say billions. To my people in the left, say billions. To my people on the right, say billions. Billions of dollars has been borrowed. And we cannot see where this money has gone. Yes, you're going to say we fed people, right? You're so busy with worrying about making sure that the country doesn't lock down. But if we actually had increased the capacity to care for people who got sick with COVID, our percentages are very good in recovery. I believe that there are more of us who are asymptomatic by far than we can shake a stick at. I believe that. So if we just had sufficient capacity to take care of those who end up getting sick so that they don't have to die from COVID, and if we were able to make sure that the people who have these ailments, these preconditions, these internal issues are able to be seen so we don't lose them either, what is the real toll? What is the real death toll of COVID-19? Someone tell me. Right? Where's the billions of dollars being spent? When the hospital today, there are 14 people sitting in a room in accident and emergency, waiting 2 and 3 days for a bed. Someone said, this is not new, Nahaja. You know what's sad? Is that's true. This is not new. But what happens when you don't listen to the professionals, when you don't listen because you're so busy trying to make sure that your special interests are taken care of? You're so trying to make sure that we make sure that these health facilities stay propped up whilst the people's health facility. I always say, you know, there's no dignity. When a teacher, a Bahamian born bred teacher, has to give birth in that maternity ward in Princess Margaret Hospital in the public ward. Any human, not just teacher, any human that has to, females, listen, y'all got to know the truth. We already don't, look, man, look here. I am a little sensitive every time I go see my gynecologist and that's a woman. I get, and her place pristine. If I got to get naked, it better be a clean place. If I got to have folks all around me, it better be spotless. Y'all don't understand. But But this is our healthcare facility. This is what we, the taxpayers, and they keep on saying, well, we need more taxes. You shouldn't get no more taxes out of me. Because you have not proven, not one iota, not one administration in recent years has proven to be responsible with my tax dollars. And when I mean responsible, not your cronies getting rich. Not your friends getting the contracts all the time. Huh? You know how crazy it is when you go into the maternity ward where life happens. Someone said I wouldn't take my dog to PMH. I tell you, I would, man, listen, you are so right. And this is sad. How many decades, centuries old is that building? We remember we used to complain and we had to have the debate on pigeon feces and why we can't keep that place. How it's diseased ridden. They build a few wards, spend tons of money on offices, but we still got people. I had a friend who was in a burn unit for months. I mean, almost a year and a half with burns, right? And I remember over their bed, the vent for the AC was over their bed. And I tell you, it looked as if it was a vent in a horror movie. That's how dirty this vent was. This is a surgical ward. This is a surgical ward. And I'm like, y'all realize, is that, oh no, it's stained black. It wasn't painted black. It was stained black. That's our facility. And listen, that's why expectation is so serious for us. Why expectations should be serious for us. Why we should have higher expectations for the position and for people who wish to run this country. They must be the best and brightest of us. And then and if we aren't getting them, because there are people who feel entitled to this thing called politics, you know, who feel entitled to this space of politics and politicking, and that they have some sort of lineage right to rule and reign over us. And they're smarter than you and I, just because of a low budget degree, or they're smarter because they've been on the road longer. You know, people been walking the beat for a candidate who's just as dumb as two dead doornails, two rusty doornails, huh? You on the beat? That's supposed to make you special? I could go on the beat right now. I could walk the street right now. For any member of parliament, I wish. But walking the beat, is the person I'm walking for competent? Can I trust them in private to lead me in public? Huh? Or expectations matter, and it's supposed to matter everywhere, all the time. Why? This is not about asking people to be superhuman. It is, if you can't reach the moon, land among the stars. The position should be where it is a loftier, common goal. But ain't no common goal, and it sure ain't lofty for us. And so we can look at the hospital and still nothing has changed. You're out of wing, but you still haven't figured out. We got politicians leading or giving directives in an administrative process called healthcare. People get degrees for administering healthcare, you know. People go to school and learn these things. People, this is a real study, science. Healthcare is a real deal. Where is our expertise in this? We put an engineer. All he gonna do is say, yes, sir. I hear you, sir. I respond to your request, sir. You need us to keep this quiet, sir. Where is the data on the vaccine? Where is the data on the AstraZeneca vaccine? Canada has finished. It is decided that it's no longer going to offer AstraZeneca. That's what it has decided to do. They had changed. They kept adjusting. They kept adjusting this. And now they've decided outrightly that they're no longer going to offer it. Right? They're no longer going to offer it. We, during this pandemic, and I know I see my guests and we're going to get switch gears. We're not going to switch gears, but we're going to bring them in. But we, in this pandemic, what were the things that they told us? Oh, we are extremely, at risk. We are a country with high comorbidities. We're a country what is that? We're obese. We have hypertension. We got diabetes. We were exceptional in this race of COVID, exceptionally negative. We got all the negatives of why COVID should wipe us out, right? But somehow we extremely exceptional and how this vaccine ain't got no effect. Where's the data? What is the numbers? Any calls, right? Any calls? And that's the challenge. Where are the calls? Where's the numbers? Has anyone called? Have we logged? Has there been any logs by physicians on the concerns of the vaccine? Right? Someone says, Nahaja, they reported 58 new cases today. 58 hospitalizations, of which 9 are intensive care and another unfortunate death. Yeah. And when people know, look, when it's your person, and this is sad. People are waiting and seeking care. When my family members needed care, I could make calls. And that's sad. That's sad. It's a benefit to me, but it's a benefit only to me and my family. It's not a benefit to you and yours, right? It's not a benefit to you and yours. And that is where the system is broken. Who you know, who you can call, how quick they can answer the phone. We need to have independent data. Should be easy at this time and this point, data should be easily extracted. United Arab Emirates, when asked, their citizens were asked about their trust in government, their government during the pandemic. The citizens gave a rating of in the 90s. How do I know this? We got Bahamian citizens who are in UAE, who are telling me that they are happy. Bahamians are happy to be in another man's country. They have taken the vaccine. They trust the process. They trust their leadership. What a time. If we did the same study here, what would be the results? We haven't even dealt with the first thing of trust. And we are talking about giving people a blight and a pass. Ladies and gentlemen, the first thing we have to do is admit out of the belly of the country came our politicians. They are the children, the fruit from the tree called us. That is where they come from. They are a part of the fabric and DNA of who we are. Now, when do we begin to say, I don't like that fruit? When do we say we got to change the soil, readjust, shift, refocus, move away from, begin to demand better, require more? Make them debate. Check to see who got stuff moving in their brains. Check it out. And when they show up young so and can't articulate, well, not even articulate. Again, it's not about being a best speaker. I tell you, Perry Christie was, he could speak, but you didn't know what was coming out of him. It's just like Negro Shakespeare. I tell all the time, Negro Shakespeare. Ask Perry Christie if the table round, he's going to tell you it's round. But somehow it's about the archipelagic nature of the Bahamas. And it was made out of the woods, out of the depths of the blue hole. It was fascinating. You ain't going to get it out your straight. It could be long and winding. Somehow poetic. You think he answered with Hubert Ingraham, whole other kettle of fish, because you don't want that laugh. It ain't about the way people are speaking. It isn't about the eloquence of the words. It's about the content. And can you deliver it where it's believable? And at the same time, I would like for you to be able to impress the world when you speak. Why people like Mia Motley? The woman to say sense every time she talk, every time she says something. Just like, woo, right? I mean, if you wait for Obama, Obama's speeches take too long. Let's dry up. But if he sheds a tear, and he was the first black president, so, you know, everything was special with him. Ladies and gentlemen, expectations matter. And I expect better from the national healthcare system we have. I expect for us as taxpayers who seek to be legal, who do not build illegally. Yes, we do build illegally. We use quiet land and all of that stuff. But then it's be legal, be based on who he is. But I digress. Who try our best to be law-abiding. Yeah? Taking note of the fact that the fish rots from the head. We pay our taxes, and when you tax us, we don't revolt. When you tax us, when you increase the gas, we don't burn down the gas station. When you take away the license from the coconut vendor, we don't show up and boise y'all with coconut. Then you do all of these things, spend millions of dollars on frivolous things and tell us it's for our good. We still somehow would show up. We still somehow would be compliant. Every time you squeeze us in the box, we keep it down. We complain, but we don't do nothing. I think it's time to do something. I think it's time to say that this is not right. You could be one of those people. How many of y'all have health insurance? How many? How many of us got health insurance? How many of y'all staying in a job that you hate because it provides health insurance? You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. When we come back, we'll be joined with Vice Chair Obi Roberts, Vice Chair of the PLP. Obi Roberts, I think Obi's birthday was sometime this week. And as he's grown older, let's see, if Obi has just grown to be nicer to this administration. I think Obi will be nicer. Oh, I hear when people get older, they get nicer. Or maybe that's just my Grammy in Exuma, because nobody else I know got nicer when they got older. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My good friend C.A. Nero will be joining us in short order as well. We'll be back after this.
Girl, Junior just showed me Bulla Boy in his phone.
What you mean? He take picture of that good for nothing boy?
Shh, you don't want Bulla hair. You say that. You know she always say that's my good child.
So what he doing in Junior phone?
Oh, he there because the police looking for him. He on that wanted list.
Wanted persons in your phone now?
Yes, child. And when police won't find anybody quick, after something happened, they can send picture direct to your phone. Go to Google Play or App Store and search for Crack Crime Bahamas, then pick install and it'll go straight to your phone.
There is also a section on missing persons.
Yes, girl. Everybody needs to get this app so police can tell us right away when these people go missing. Just like an alert system.
Yes, it has numbers for Crime Stoppers Bahamas so you can call and nobody knows you. Call directly to Miami and give the information without giving your name or anything about you. I tried the other day, and when I hear Junior and his boys talking about where they hide those guns, I walk quick round the corner and call that number.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands. This traffic report is brought to you by Shield Insurance and Prudential Law Adjusters.
First look at traffic this afternoon, and the mid-level afternoon traffic look that we see out there is on. West Bay Street already has that slow traffic that's heading west. Inner City Wolf Road, not heavy, just a moderate traffic flow moving along that car repair in both directions. You've got congestion delays along Tawny's Way and Darling, though. First, you've got the east lanes that head into that Blue Hill Road roundabout. They are delayed and backed up there. Then you've also got traffic that's heading into the roundabout. There you've got some delayed lines heading into that roundabout there at Blue Hill Road. Then there's the Malabala Highway roundabout. At that high level of traffic on either side of the roundabout. First, heading into the circle on the west side is that single lane coming off of JFK. That has the traffic stacked up there. Then you've got cars on the east side heading west into that circle, and you've got a stack of lines there as well. And from the north side, there's another stack of cars coming through, passing Millennium Gardens, and slowing down to get through the circle at that point. The Carmichael Road and Blue Hill Road Junction, very busy right now. The ride home along Carmichael Road is not as bad, though. East Street in the south, very busy on both sides of the lane there. And Soldier Road is quite active at this time of the day, both directions, especially between Abundant Life and Old Trail Road. It's that after-school crew. And so it is with Prince Charles Drive. The ride over there got a few slowdowns that are quite evident. Overall, slowdowns and congestion at this point is few and far between. This NASA traffic report is service of Dr. Danny Johnson Associates at Foot and Ankle International, who offers the simplest and safest treatment for foot injuries, ingrown toenails, corns, heel pain, and more. Visit Foot and Ankle International for relief. They're located Dean's Lane atop the hill at Fort Charlotte. Call them at 322-5402. That's 322-5402 for more info. With your Rhino Sky look at traffic in real time, I'm VA Double Ad.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you will also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to a Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
When I had got prostate cancer, my family didn't know if I was going to live. At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number. They see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. That's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Listening to the Hit Back with Nahaja Black, like I told y'all, listen, I definitely believe this is a vaccine headache. Yeah, because I've had it since, what day is this? I don't remember what day I had the shot. What day? Monday. Y'all don't understand. Y'all don't even. I'm so happy my light came on time, because then I would have had to drive to studio. Yeah? And boy, look at God. BPL worked in my favor. Huh? Light came on, doing the show from home. I got my good friend, C.A. Nuri, all the way from wherever that Fox Hill Bush is. And my other good friend, and happy birthday, belated birthday to Obi Roberts. When I say good friend, Obi Wise, if I say good friend, people think we go out to lunch or something. We ain't never been out to lunch ever. I call you my radio friend.
How you doing, Nahaja? How you doing, C.A.?
That's be concerned when she call other people good friend of them. And I'm the only one who's go out. I be watching every week. Just know this is my good friend, and I'm watching. I'm not a special friend anymore.
You are. I mean, I can't listen. I would say real friends, but you can't say that, because then it would mean that the others are fake. So words are very powerful. We're good friends. Good friends.
Okay? I'm just letting you know. I feel some type of way when you introduce other people as good friend and my special friend, and this is my next CA Nuri. And I said, okay, I'm watching.
I never said that. I can't recall.
I remember the show. There's something about computers or economics. And this is another. Anyway, I digress.
Nahaja, also happy belated Mother's Day to you as well, madam. And the other mothers and bombers as well.
Oh, thank you, my friend. It's good to have you both on. Listen, I have, there's so much to talk about. And Obi, I know when we chatted last week, you're hot to trot on a particular topic. So I have that space carved out for you on that. But I wanted to get your thoughts on something that I was sharing earlier when you guys weren't on, that I've been getting information. Like right now, we have 14 people admitted into the hospital at Princess Margaret Hospital. Admitted, meaning they got files, doctors come and see them, or the nurse comes and sees them, they check their blood, whatnot. But these 14 people are in one room together. And personally, I'm going to show you, you guys, privately, what some of the photos look like, right? But they're in this square room that's no more, based on the photos, maybe the size of a master bedroom in like a regular space, right? And these 14 people, some are in wheelchairs, others just sitting in chairs. They've been in there for days, sleeping in chairs. There are no beds. There's no room. They are not COVID positive yet. That's what some of the patients said. Yet. Yes. Right? Yet. Because, of course, they're fed. They're being fed. And this is them. Once they've been admitted, they get taken off the porch. And now they are in a room. 14 days. I've spoken to quite a few administrators to confirm that, even though they'd shown me photos, and one of the persons is the patient, confirmed. This is happening. One gentleman had a seizure while sitting in the chair. They addressed the seizure, but he's still in the chair. Right? This is our healthcare. They don't have COVID, guys. This is not a COVID where, we're overflood. But we are in COVID times, and this means that those issues are present, but that there's a larger health issue here. And I want to get your take on it. I personally, I feel I am saying that we're in a health crisis, and it's not just because of the pandemic. Overall, the health system is broken. Our health care with regard to Princess Margaret Hospital is broken. I want to get your thoughts. Obi, I'll start with you.
Nahaja, we have been having some issues with our health system for some time. I commend the doctors as they perform their jobs as best as they can. COVID has only further made it even more difficult in our health system with the many persons who are coming in with like symptoms or have tested positive for COVID. And that story, which you just explained to me and CA and the general public, that's a heartbreaking one, because if the persons have not been diagnosed or tested positive for COVID and they've been sitting in there for days, then what are they in there for? And when are they going to be served and have the opportunity to be discharged to go home to their families? Because what you just explained to us, if they don't have COVID and there's a possibility that they can contract COVID without them knowing, they could take it home to their families, and then that vicious cycle begins in their home or in their community.
For the record, I just want to make clear, what I was told is that everyone in this room has been tested and they came back negative with COVID. So that's what, for the record, they did not put them in there willy-nilly. They were tested, PCR tested, and they were negative. Sia, your thoughts on it?
The issue here is about what we plan to do and not necessarily what the problem is. We know that we've been having some challenging times with the hospital in general, but we continue to talk at it, at the problem, and then being talked about another 5 years, another 10 years. So the question is, what are we prepared to do as a community and as a nation as a whole? If the government is challenged in creating a new space for the hospital, if they are challenged at filling beds and medication and whatever else is needed for the hospital, then the general public needs to step in. Then the private entities need to step in and then contribute. So clearly there's a need for us to have a complete analysis of what the situation is, to say that we are short. How many beds are we short? And we write that down. How many space we are short? Then write that down. And then you come to the Bahamian public and the Bahamian business community and say, well, can you partner with us? Have another PPP? And say, well, we need this much amount of space. This is how much it's going to cost. We don't have the money. If you are prepared to make us go to the next level, all heads and hands will be on deck, all shoulders will be on the wheel. But they continuously need to talk about it again and again and complain.
Well, this is where
it's happening. And then we stop.
This is where I think you hit something on the head there. What I've learned is that, listen, okay, first of all, to note, we have wards under construction. We've had wards under construction apparently for years, right? Going on certain areas, just years, just waiting. We need to know what is the status. Why are things not being completed, right? You asked a great question there. Okay, well, what are the challenges? Well, you listen, and if this was a brand new conversation, I could say, okay, yeah, well, we need to know this data. But consecutive administrations have had this challenge. And this is information. If there was intention to solve healthcare, Cecil, if there was intention to solve healthcare, what you're asking would have already been brought to the fore. My question then is, where is the intention? Where is the intention? Is this important? We're talking about talking at it, but do people know at this point that if you go to the hospital, you're going to have to wait days if you get admitted, right, to find a bed? Do people understand, or is there an alternative that says, okay, yeah, you can go to the clinics, but what is the process of that? How clear is that? Where are the channels of discourse? Is the function in creating more suitable healthcare, is there something that is funneling people to get healthcare today so that we can deal with it later? Just another point to add. Dwayne Sands, when he was minister, I'm aware that he was embarking on a plan, a deal, or not a deal, but in a proposition where he was trying to receive or get funding to expand the hospital. And I think you'll remember, he was talking about expanding the hospital, right? There was a different lots. I don't know if you guys remember that. You remember that, Obi?
Mm-hmm.
And he felt as if he was quite close to getting the necessary hundreds of millions of dollars in support during Dorian. to begin to make that happen, right? What happened to that? Where is that idea of expansion? Where, how much are we spending right now today on other facilities that are private versus what we could be doing right now? Where, apart from that, we know that physicians and staff have been asking for more staff. We need more nurses. This has been a cry before COVID. We need more doctors. We've been told since this administration came in, they want less doctors. Since this pandemic, doctors have been begging for them to instate junior doctors. So it isn't something where everything needs to come to the public. This is a function of administration. Do we have the tools? Is there too much politics in our healthcare that is causing healthcare to fall apart? This thing can work, Cecil. When we take a lot of the politics out of it, I believe that it can work. And not everything needs to come to the people until you need the people. I don't even think the people will buy in at this point that these people are capable and competent for me to give them my beds.
But I would like to say that there has been movement within the Bahamas healthcare. By example, you see that there's copious amount of clinics opening all over the place on the family islands and inclusive in Nassau, or even specialized clinics.
But buildings with no people, see, so lots of people in Exuma. You got a whole brand new clinic that's fancy as heck. I can tell you, I know the sister who left because of politics and healthcare. Don't listen, they build buildings like nobody's business. We got a lot of buildings at NHI, our taxpayer dollars. Then pay for how much hundreds of millions of dollars get wiped off for buildings just so people can thief money. I'm impressed with buildings, boo. Sorry.
You see that the establishment of the PHA and that the administration and management of the hospital is better than it was before. We see the establishment of the new wing. I mean, it's beautiful. I thought it was going to be hospital rooms, but the key is office.
That's the next one. We digress.
The point of all of that is there has been movement. But I'm not sure if the movement answers the problems that we are facing in our healthcare. And the only way we can address the problems we're facing in healthcare is to identify the needs of the general community. We don't know as yet how much beds do we need to service an island of New Providence. How many doctors do we need to service an island of New Providence? How many clinics do we need to service an island of New Providence? And once we have that data, do we have it in the process of being built or coordinated, or are we lacking in that? We don't know if we even have sufficient. So this is where we're at. And perhaps there needs to be a management, overall management team, just to answer that problem, and then a team to initiate and bring these things into fruition.
Yeah, great points. Obi?
Nahaja, well, I'll tell you this. Under the forms...
Wait. Hold on. Sorry, Obi. I'm so sorry. 4:40, let's go to the news. As soon as we come back, I want you to chime in. We got to take the news break. My apologies, Obi, on that one. All right. You're listening to The Hit Bag with Nahaja Black, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. We'll be back right after this.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
You're listening to the Guardian News Network. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's what's making news. Thank you for tuning in. Two Florida senators expressing their objection to exploratory drilling in Bahamian waters and urging U.S. Secretary of State Anthony Blinken to engage the Bahamas government to ensure both countries are prepared to respond to an oil spill should one occur. The letter, signed by Senators Marco Rubio and Rick Scott, it's a warning Save the Bay's Executive Chairman Joe Darvall said government ought to listen to.
I would say that we would be extremely foolish if we did not pay serious 100% heed to what the authorities are saying in Florida, and not just the authorities in Florida, but we have a list of senators from both political entities.
The senators said in the letter, although BPC has reportedly determined the site is not viable for additional drilling, it's their understanding additional leases in Bahamian waters some 50 miles from Florida's shores are still valid through 2026. Governor General His Excellency Cornelius Smith getting his second shot of the AstraZeneca COVID-19 vaccine today. He described it as less painful and stressed the importance of Bahamians getting inoculated.
What I'm looking forward to is that other Bahamians, all Bahamians, decide that they would want to come and make sure that they get vaccinated. They make sure that we can open up our country so that our economy begins to tick again, that there are more jobs become available, and we have both a healthy country and a country where everybody is fully employed.
58 new COVID-19 cases reported by the Ministry of Health yesterday, 56 of those cases on New Providence, one each on Grand Bahama and Eleuthera. The ministry also reporting an unfortunate non-COVID-19 related death. An 88-year-old male from New Providence died yesterday. And that's what's making news. I'm Taylor Ferguson. AP News is coming up next.
CDC mask change. I'm Tim McGuire with an AP News Minute. The CDC makes a big change to its pandemic mask guidance.
Based on the continuing downward trajectory of cases, the scientific data on the performance of our vaccines, and our understanding of how the virus spreads, that moment has come for those who are fully vaccinated.
People who have had their coronavirus shots can now stop wearing masks outdoors in crowds and in most indoor settings. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention Director Dr. Rochelle Walensky says people who are traveling, both fully vaccinated and not vaccinated, should still wear the mask. President Biden says those who haven't been vaccinated should do so as soon as possible.
As great as this announcement is today, we don't want to let up.
The country's aggressive vaccination campaign has paid off. Cases are at their lowest rate since September. Deaths are at their lowest point since last April. And the positive test rate is at its lowest point since the pandemic began. I'm Tim McGuire.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
We're back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. My phone's blowing up with information. It's interesting stuff. I got my good friend, Obi Roberts. See? That didn't feel right, Cecil. It didn't feel right because then I can say I got my good friend, C.A. Nuri, joining me on the show. I have to work on it, see? I mean, you know, every person is a brother and sister in Christ. You know what I mean? Unless there's sickness. And then
it
I got
it is what it is. I just said I'm noticing. I'm noticing the stuff. It's a trend now. And I don't like it.
You know, I you're my brother first. I love you first, boo.
Yeah.
You're my beeps.
Yeah.
For the record, folks who don't know, Cecil makes a mean pepper sauce, right? Like a mean pepper sauce. I see, this is how you know it's be family.
Mm.
And my husband is the only one, and he don't like pepper. But somehow, Cecil do something, and my husband is the only one who truly enjoys the sauce, Cecil. So this is we're family now. Mm. You know, This is it. This is it. I eat your pepper sauce in my house. It is make my fish. Just throw that out there.
Yeah.
Someone, yeah, this is, I don't get nothing from Obi.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Obi, belated Mother's Day present. He just said Happy Mother's Day, and it's like two Sundays late. All right. It's good to have you guys on. All right, Obi, before we went on a break, you were going to respond with regard to healthcare, right?
Mm-hmm.
So your thoughts.
Well, Nahaja, I mean, the Progressive Liberal Party, if persons were paying attention during the last administration, we were, and the last two Christie administrations, we were heavily in support of advancing NHI to make healthcare affordable for the average Bahamian. Mm-hmm. And just before we had lost going the 2017 elections, many, many, many Bahamians were signing up to NHI for them to at least have access to affordable to the primary healthcare. And it's interesting when I read, this was a couple months ago in the Guardian newspaper, the former Minister of Health, Wayne Sands, to quote his words, he wants the Bahamas to end this medical apartheid and to advance, as I would say, I would quote him, the Bahamas will face a healthcare disaster if the national health insurance does not fulfill its potential. He warned, and we must get past this deep-stated debate. Quote, Mr. Sands, we held the cabinet post, and he was just primarily speaking that we must implement NHI to give the average Bahamian access to health care. And Nahaja, I think you were asking how many persons have health insurance.
My people at NHI, and that came in handy. I will say that. You're right.
More than 200,000 Bahamians before a person started to sign up there, sign up to NHI under the former administration did not have access or did not have health care. And you had many persons who could not afford it. Insurance was too costly. And many persons were developing simple illnesses or from injuries, and those illnesses got worse and progressively worse. Some persons may have died from them. And these are simple things that we generally overlook. People thinking because, okay, if one is primarily overweight or they have some bad practice, whether drinking, smoking, or simply overweight. But say, for instance, a family of two or three, a mother has a son who may have broken his arm. She doesn't have the money to take him to the hospital to get a cast on, to set his arm straight. Something like that could lead to further debilitating injuries with his arm. It could get progressively worse over the years. But these are things that every Bahamian should have at least access to affordable health care, primary care. And under the Progressive Liberal Party, NHI proposed if you had one child or if you had 10, under that parent, they would automatically receive health care from the age of 1 all the way up to 21. And if you were in college, that would cover you up to the age of 25. And so we notice under this administration that they've been kicking the can down the road. And we have a doctor who is the prime minister. So we would assume that they would have put health care first as he's a physician himself. And I mean, he's on.
Well, he was the Minister of Health as well. I mean, I'm well past your career determining your intention, right? Mm-hmm. Like I'm past that to a state, especially when it comes to health, right? Mm-hmm. I'm well over it. So that's interesting. I will say this, because I have family who use NHI, I've seen it in action, right? Mm-hmm. And so I do appreciate it. And I do believe that we are failing to use NHI in an even more effective way.
Agreed.
NHI and its technology, what it's capable of, because of, you know, getting to talk with the persons within NHI, we should be, and this is one of the things with healthcare in this country, healthcare is only expensive if we stay unhealthy. Healthcare can be less expensive for all of us as taxpayers if we become healthier. Mm-hmm. I'm still waiting on them bread basket items where the healthy stuff was supposed to show up, Cecil. I'm waiting on that.
The corned beef?
Don't watch nothing that was important. For people who love corned beef, don't be hating on my corned beef. All right? Just throw that out there. Ain't nothing like some good corned beef with jasmine rice. Because you got to upscale it now. You got to upscale it. It used to be parboiled, but now I got extra $1.25. I can get jasmine. My point is, jasmine rice would be legit with that corned beef, boy. But I digress. All right. Sorry. Cost me loose focus. there is opportunity where we can be healthier. What I mean, with us discussing healthcare is not only just technology, which is important. It is important. We need to be able to track things. We need to determine where clusters are with healthcare. What is the demographics of this issue? Why is obesity so high in this country? What is the, is there a cluster of hypertensive patients coming out of this community? Why is that? We should have had healthcare data already. And this is my thing. This is why, Obi, I love you, but you know, your party got to get whipped, right? Because when we're talking about healthcare as well, for me, NHI, when, if we maximize it, if we truly were talking about healthcare, certain things should have already been in as a data center. Where this is why healthcare matters to me. Because whatever happened with Rubus and Marathon, that's a health crisis. That's a health issue. Health should have been there. And public safety should have already given us the reports and the data and determined for us through statistical information that the people of Marathon are safe. Not waiting on cabinet to give me a report and allow the companies to change their name, allow private entities to get funds. See, this is why, for me, when we talk about healthcare, it got to be true. We got to be intentional. We got to be really interested in the health of the people and not in rhetoric or saying we did one or two things, because unhealthy people cost taxpayers money. Yes, NHI is great. And that, again, happened under the Christie administration. I understand that. It ain't changed the fact that he's still out and y'all can't bring that back and he ain't coming back. Tell the people of Centerville, Reese is the MP. I digress. What is going on with healthcare must be intentional. Healthy people, unhealthy people cost the country money. And the PLP needs to tell the Bahamian people today, how are we going to have a plan to get the healthcare system in order? It can't just be about buildings. We've been building buildings and doctors still short, nurses still short. It has to be very much on how do we get this the country healthy? And so we can reduce the costs. And I think NHI is a great start because that's some tech that we could use. And we got brilliant people in that building. I know that.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we build on that? And that's what I want to hear. I personally, as a voter, Obi, I don't want to hear about what y'all did in the past. I want to know what we're going to build in the past.
Well, Nahaja.
And I like to say it starts with healthy eating. You're right on that.
But Nahaja, if I may. One of the things besides NHI that the PLP, and remember this now, we weren't, because of the people of the Bahamas decided to vote in the free national movement, we weren't allowed to finish our job. One of the things that we also implemented in North Angeles was Bounty, and that is also healthy eating, chemically free food that is grown, okay? Instead of us, and so we'll be less dependent of importing food into the Bahamas. We will grow healthy food to ensure that the Bahamians will be eating healthy food, chemically free, on Nahaja. What we have been noticing over the years is a lot of Bahamians, young Bahamians, are getting sick at a much younger age from illnesses that doctors are finding it strange that persons in their 20s and 30s and even their 40s are being sick of. Is it the food that we're bringing in that is contributing to it? The diet? You talk about obesity. Our diet is one thing that we have in our country. We eat a lot of starch, from rice to macaroni to potato salad to fried food. The fried foods, that's a lot of starch. And then on top of that, you add sugar from sodas and juice, and you also have alcohol. So part of our health issues is also self-inflicted, in which we have to encourage Bahamians to eat healthy and then also grow healthy food. BAMSI is a key component to that. All right. And we had a deal, this happened in 2015, when BAMSI struck a deal with Super Value, then with Rupert Roberts, in which they were selling food in Super Value. And it was a win-win situation where Bahamians could benefit from fruits and vegetables that was grown from BAMSI. And we got to continue the education.
Mm-hmm.
And that is one of the ways that we could also help stymie this increase of obesity and diabetes.
Hypertension,
hypertension. But with us, we're planning to continue what we had began under the last administration, because we were going to tie NHI into this is what we discussed, into NHI was going to be in the buildings where you had national insurance throughout the archipelago. So we're going to use two in one and use the system. So when persons had come in and started to pay their dues and NIB, The same thing would have been applied to NHI, and persons could have received their benefits from that, Nahaja. But that was one thing that we had planned from back then, and we only can continue to build from that. We have a foundation. We have a plan. Remember now, we were the party that was implemented, that was the champion for implementing NHI when the Free National Movement had opposed it. Now, and the thing that they were saying then was we did not have a plan for catastrophic health care. Now that talk has changed from Dr. Sands. He wants to see the full the fulfillment of NHI so every Bahamian can have access to health care. I'm happy to see that he's changed his tune on that, because you remember the comment that was said some time ago with Mr. Christian, I think then Minister of Health, that was Dr. Perry Gomez, and just quoting, if you are poor and if you're Black and if you are unhealthy in this country, you will die because you do not have, most Bahamians cannot afford health care. We would like to change that as its most simplest way for Bahamians to at least be able to go to the doctor and check their blood pressure and check their sugar levels. Things that they don't have that pleasure of doing today because they don't have the monies to do it, at least they'll have that opportunity, and that will begin the process of monitoring one's health. Nahaja.
Excellent. And, you know, you make great points there. CA, I saw you shake your head. I want to get your thoughts on it before we switch gears.
I'm just saying that our government need to be committed to invest in private enterprise. There needs to be some more PPPs, public-private partnerships. Mm-hmm. Clearly, I'm thinking of Centerville and Collins Avenue, where there's smaller mini hospitals that way. Perhaps there's a need for government to partner with these small private clinics and invest inside some of those and say, hey, I see you are specializing in women health. We are prepared to give you $1, $2, $3, $4 million so you have the right set of equipment that we can move people from the Princess Margaret Hospital in a gynecology ward and say we're at a discount because they help invest in your company, your business, that we can send some women down there to get some specialty treatment. And perhaps that is the way moving forward in terms of oncology, in terms of gynecology.
But what about midwifery? What even about that? I think there's a legislature, a policy there for midwives or some sort of legislature that nurses would like to have passed. Problem is that, listen, in healthcare in this country, there are special interests. Mm-hmm. Like everywhere else, there are special interests. And I think before I could even trust the government, I can't even trust the government with museums. I can't even trust the government with monuments and forts. You know how stressful that is? But you'd be like, but dude, that's all your people. Like, we don't even trust when they won't give away land. You're like, oh, dude, that's all your people. I mean, I hear you, but I don't trust you. Before Cecil, I could even, any PPP, right, shows up in my sphere with healthcare, I think we need to get to a place where there is actual transparency and accountability. Because we end up spending more on corruption. Our prime minister said it very well internationally. He went to great lengths to debate or to share how corrupt we were and how much money we lose through corruption. But yet we have not become more transparent in all of this. And so even when we discuss healthcare, when I assure you, my friend, money is being made in this pandemic. There are people who are getting extremely wealthy during this pandemic. And so before I think we can even talk about PPPs, I think we need to get to a place where there's a full-on assessment of what we have, where there is room for growth. Can we grow if we clean up all of the leakages? If we stop all of where is money coming through? I mean, again, the Prime Minister spoke about corruption. And to speak about corruption is an understanding that there is a problem here. Where are the spaces that there are problems? How can we resolve these problems? Stop the leakages in these areas. Bring clarity and accountability and illumination so that we can resolve this. And when we've reached that and fixed those things and we stop the leakages, then you say, okay, the boat isn't sinking now. Now let's talk about expansion. Or now let's talk about adding people to the vessel. Can we make it bigger? Can we create from a dinghy to whatever, can we grow? I don't think we've even done the assessment or to the place where we stopped the leakages, but then we're talking about spending money or bringing people in. And I think that's how corruption and corruption makes us spend more as taxpayers. So I agree with you, but I think we're far from there because we are still so broken. And I agree with you. We need PPPs, though.
You made a comment earlier regarding the young doctors. It seems like this government seems to be somewhat hostile towards the young doctors.
Hostile towards union men. I don't even think it got to be just unions.
And then the nurses as well, because when you speak to some of the nurses out that way, they seem to be very upset with the doctors, with the government primarily. But how much times we have seen the young doctors protest under this particular government? And we've seen their union demonstrating, and we see a major, seems like it's a major separation between the senior doctors and the younger doctors right now, in particularly when we need them the most to come together under this this COVID pandemic right now that we're facing.
Well, I tell you, I agree with you. I agree with you. It's sad. I've had them all on my show. Every single union I can find, leader within the medical facility, medical world in this country, I've had on my show because, I'm an advocate for them. It's easy to say stuff on the other side when you're in an office, Lobby. I'm watching your PLPs. I'm watching your Lobby. Watching.
Nahaja, like I said, right now, you can hold us accountable, Nahaja. One of the things is there, we are the official opposition, and we are here to help the government run the country better, But when you hear the prime minister sit there and say he no need to listen to Philip Brave Davis, that sounds like a person who wants to come together to advance the country during a most critical juncture of our country's history, whether it's Hurricane Dorian or whether it's the COVID pandemic. We are here. Mm-hmm. The leader of the opposition is one election from becoming prime minister. We have to demonstrate majority because we have to run a country for the benefit of Bahamian people, not for the select few. So that is most foremost and important, the lives and livelihood of the Bahamian people. And if you
are elected, let's switch gears now. I want to switch gears. We got Obi Roberts, vice chair of the Progressive Liberal Party, C.A. Nuri, my good friend. Celebrity blogger, Facebook extraordinaire. And see, look at God. Had him freeze right there with his bald head in the frame. And, of course, we are talking some of the headlines today. All right, guys. So something else that's been going on, major in the news, right? We've made the international news. This was with regard to housing. And I'm going to say housing. I don't even want to say immigration because, I want to call it a housing issue because we're not – this is – we have another incident in Abaco where we are breaking down shanty towns, shanty homes, right? Homes and villages. Illegal structures, illegal communities that are not built to code, et cetera, et cetera. The Minister of Works said, listen, we as a people have to decide, do we want to be Haiti or do we want to be the Bahamas, right? And I thought it was... It reminded me of the Trump's bleep hole country for a second there, right? Like, kind of rang a little bit. But there were some things that I'm like, okay, you know what? I agree with, right? I agree with that there must be standards. I agree that we must stand and say, hey, no, you can't do this thing. There are Bahamians who are homeless today. How many homes they said in whatever that street, what was it, Jenny Street?
In Anglison?
Anglison? It's Marathon.
Marathon. Marathon, yes.
Yeah. So we got Bahamians who are homeless, right? And they're alleging, or what was being reported, is that the majority of these persons in Abaco are of Haitian descent or are Haitian workers who are transplanted, whatnot. I'm curious, and I wanted to get your thoughts on this. Was the minister's response... inappropriate,
yes,
as a whole, right, as a whole,
yes,
over there parts that were redeemable. And I want to go with you, CA. You start,
yes, because see, I'm saying yes again and again, it's inappropriate. But, the issue is not necessarily immigration, the issue is housing. And let's start off with there,
and
housing.
That's where I think it is.
Is there a housing crisis in Abaco? Yes, we know that there isn't enough homes in Abaco for anyone at this present time. There are people, even expatriates who come down to help and facilitate the construction of buildings, who are living in tents in order to help Bahamians. And they're prepared to live and help inside of tents in order to help Bahamians, because there aren't any apartments, there aren't any houses, there aren't any hotels that they can live in. So there's a housing crisis. Now, the question is, since Dorian, has there been any construction of low-cost homes?
No.
There's to be no effort to solve it. Now, mind you, there's been some land put aside to say that sometime in the future,
and wood's rotting.
God willing. But there hasn't been any solution in terms of any low-cost housing. Then we need to determine what is low-cost housing. Are we talking about these $100,000 houses that the government is issuing? You know, we know that Abaco has a number of construction personnel there who are professional, who can build the code, right? Mm-hmm. However, there has been no mechanism put in place to say, hey, we are in urgent need of some housing in 6 months, because you could build a house in 3 months, right? So there's an urgent need to build this number of houses within a year. That hasn't been happening as yet.
No.
So what do poor people do who live in Abaco, who are participating in the restructuring and the construction of Abaco? Where do they live in the meantime? They either live in the tent, or they construct shoddy houses.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not condoning the construction of any shanty town. They need to be demolished. They need to be demolished immediately, right? Mm-hmm. Forthwith. But the issue is, when you demolish these houses, and I'm only speaking for the Bahamians because I can't speak for the immigrants, because the immigrants, I assume, immigration is taking care of them. So that's not an issue for me. That's a non-issue, and I'm not going to bring it up, right? Because that's an immigration problem. I'm concerned about persons who are Bahamians, who are living inside these shoddy and shanty towns. If you bulldoze their homes, only for the Bahamians now, what mechanism is in place that you can move these Bahamians to? And if there's no mechanism in place, the government has a duty of care to these Bahamians. And I want to know what is in place at this present time for them.
And I like the line that you tried to delineate, saying, okay, you're only talking about for the Bahamians, right? Yeah. Because, and I love that you said, because immigration, the Department of Immigration should be dealing with the non-Bahamians if they are here illegally.
And that's if there is no... send them home, by the way. He raised on it from a couple of years ago.
Okay.
All you all go home.
So and there was a deadline. Yeah, and deadline. If there is no work, then there should be no work permit, right? Okay. These things should be settled and clear. I see you, Obi. I see your lips moving. Go there.
Nahaja, anyone who's been following this government since they came to office, and particularly the many comments that have come from the prime minister regarding immigration, he's only been paying lip service. You just mentioned it a moment ago. He got up and he told every person who was here illegally, have until December 31st to leave the country. What did they do when that day came and gone? Not a thing at all. We have seen how this government has been extremely soft on immigration. We have seen the various videos that have been circulating around town, no later than Abaco, where you had some persons who were living in a bus, and they make the makeshift a bus, and that's in the center of Dundas Town in central North Abaco.
I had Kai Mills on the show. Kai Mills was the one with the video. Kai showed me the whole thing.
And it's amazing. And this is right off of the main road, right, several feet off of the main road where people drive past every single day. And the questions that Bahamians ask is this: we can't do this in our own country, but we have persons who come in here illegally and then build shanty homes or homes that don't meet the building codes, or what we've seen with the bus and many other things that are taking place in this country, and they are not challenged, questioned, or arrested until where you have the situation with Kaiman said he had to actually bring a camera there, and make a spectacle of the matter that drew the attention of the authorities, that they had to go down there. But Bahamians are frustrated with this, that they're seeing that I can't go and squat on someone's online. When I build, got to get a building code, building permit, and meet all of the requirements. But persons who not born here, and there's nothing personal, but just us following the rules. Bahamians follow the rules, but non-Bahamians come here, don't follow the rules, and they are permitted to do what they like. And we're seeing it as we're being treated as second-class citizens in our own country. And that frustrates a lot of Bahamians. I had that conversation no later than today. And it just seems as if right now that, okay, and the comment that was made was, is this because of the election time drawing near and they're seeing this as a possibility to obtain votes? Whether it is or not, it is a great disservice that you're doing.
Who would be obtaining votes with this? Who would be, because it can't be the FNM trying to obtain votes with this. If we're talking about the fact or the belief system that many within the shanty town are non-Bahamians, then the FNM is not winning points with this. Now, I was told that the Progressive Liberal Party is trying to garner votes off of this. I'm trying to figure out if that's correct, and that's why I'm glad you're here, Obi. What is the position of the Progressive Liberal Party on this matter?
Nahaja, you want me to go back in history?
No, I want you to go to this one. What's your position?
Nahaja, the PLP has always been firm on immigration. We have always been firm, and I see, Nur, you shaking your head, and I could bring some facts to you. It was us under the former administration when Fred Mitchell was the Minister of Immigration, when we put in immigration laws to make it much more difficult for illegal immigrants to come in to have access to our health care and our education. Let me remind Mr. Nuri and the general public that, you know, it was the PLP that imposed that, and Fred Mitchell caught internal hell from the international agencies for that when he was trying to put in legislation in place that protects the interests of Bahamians. Bahamians in our educational system as well, and our healthcare system. How much times we have heard Bahamians complain that we have had non-Bahamians come in and get direct free access?
See, so you remember when Fred, I do remember Fred Mitchell was talking about a card. You remember that? A card, a national ID.
And so.
The longest permit and stuff like that.
Exactly. And that was for persons to come here, pay your taxes, open up a bank account, but you're unable to vote in our country's general elections. And that was a brilliant move by the then PLP government led by Mr. Mitchell at that time of protecting the interests of Bahamians. And remember how many times he had wars with Fred Smith when they were saying that we were operating an Auschwitz camp down at the detention center. All of these things that were trying to bring negative light when we were just simply trying to enforce our immigration laws. Our stance remains just as strong then as it is now with that. And we want any person that comes into the country to adhere to our rules. Now, when we saw Mr. Davis a few weeks ago, he was talking to the Haitian Bahamian community, who persons here who are legal, who are born here, and simply who are adhering to our laws of the land. And that's simply it. We don't encourage persons to break our laws, especially immigration laws. That is a very sensitive and touchy situation. But the whole matter, the structure of the homes and persons building shanty towns, we don't condone that, Nahaja. And we want all persons to adhere to that.
Nahaja, I pay no attention to Obi pontificating,
That's a fact.
For years, they have been given work permits. In fact, brag that they have record numbers of work permits.
No, sir.
Who you giving work permits to?
No, CA, that was Brent Seminar.
Where are these work permits coming from?
Hold on a week.
If you go into Abaco right now.
Hold on.
We know that when the Yon folks did the census, a number of them, the majority of them, had status to be into the Bahamas. Who gives a person living in a shanty town a work permit? It's impossible. See, that's corruption inside the system. And something is wrong. And then you try to find out when were these permits issued. They were issued under the PLP. They were issued under
them.
Hold on, Obi.
And we need to be concerned. So when you see people like Obi come and say, we better than the FNM, you have to hold your head and shake your head and say, these people take you a fool, man. And I ain't no fool. I know better. And all this pandering to these new Bahamians and these immigrants who are doing in transition. See, I understand this gameplay. Every election is the same thing. And now we see you call them, you're on Haitian no more. You're Bahamian of Haitian descent. We've heard that speech before. You know, they only love you when you need you. And the election time is close. And that's what they're doing. They're pandering them. And
they're pandering now.
Stop it.
Our good friend C.A. Nuri apparently has some selective memory or amnesia. Because it was Brent Theodore Simonet who was Minister of Immigration on two occasions, who got up in the House Assembly and bragged how much money the government was bringing in terms of work permits that they were handing out. You have selected Memory Nassie. It was Brent Simmons, not no PLP who did that. It was under both F&M governments, the last Hubert Ingham government when Brent Simmons served as Minister of Immigration, and this time. And that was one of their sources of major revenue when they said they were offering work permits. Come on, CA. I remember that loud and clear. We don't brag about that because we were the party that advances behavioralization and want to get Bahamians jobs. How can we contradict ourselves in that matter?
But let me ask this, and a great point there, because actually I cannot say that I recall either, but both of y'all, all I remember saying as a voter, both parties was doing fool with immigration. That's the first thing. I just know that we haven't resolved immigration. Under no administration have we seen true advancement of the resolution in the issues of immigration. We have not addressed the gaping hole with Article 7. None has taken it and moved to remove the pitfall of that sinking after 18. What is that? Where are we with that? That's a big issue with the Bahamian people. So we haven't dealt with those issues, right? But nonetheless, let me go here with this point here, Obi. Mm-hmm. In the move now with the Progressive Liberal Party, because we do know that you guys are going to pander for votes. You're going to go for the votes. You're going to, politically, you're going to use this as a voting tool and mechanism. People are seeing a video now, and we don't know if it's true or not. And I wish that's what I want you to confirm. There's a gentleman with a thick Haitian accent in a PLP shirt saying, vote PLP. And it is circulating on social media. And I wanted to know, is that one of your persons on the campaign trail? And what is the plan to garner the votes of that particular block of people who are eligible voters? I assume they got to be eligible voters, right?
Nahaja, I don't know. I have not seen the video, but Nahaja, anyone could put on any political party shirts and speak in terms of...
I agree. And that's why I wanted you to say whether or not that was true or not. Is that a
There's another video with a gentleman walking with marathon with a prospective MP or candidate in marathon. But I digress. I'm just saying it's several videos of seeing gentlemen.
So you've seen more than I've seen.
Well, there you go. But so I don't want him to say anyone can put on a shirt. The person put on a shirt and even with a PLP. So
who was the candidate, CA?
I'm not going to call the lady name. Tommy's a nice lady.
But now, Nahaja, with that, Nahaja, we are seeing a lot of people also expressing their views, all right, of what is going on in the country and who they choose to support. Now, I did not see the video that you were alluding to or the various videos that CA is alluding to. I can't say yay or nay to that. But anyone can put on shirts. Some persons can speak falsehood and some people can speak also truth. But I never seen them. But Nahaja, what we are gathering right now is many Bahamians are speaking from their frustrations under this government.
But it's not a new frustration. It's not a... This one, to me, this is why I immigration isn't a new frustration. This isn't under the Free National Movement only. It has definitely been under the Progressive Liberal Party. Where the Bahamian people are, stop playing games with immigration, man.
Nahaja, what we are seeing, a new form under this immigration... of this government under immigration is what we've seen with the implementation of the Commercial Enterprise Act. When you've seen them allow persons or state by policy for you to qualify under the Commercial Enterprise Act, you need to invest $250,000. The average Bahamian cannot afford that. So who you think is going to benefit? The foreigner or the person who have means? Then you also see the second phase of that Commercial Enterprise Act and where they weaken the laws to allow foreigners to come in and compete for jobs that Bahamians could get. That's another form of immigration that hurts the Bahamian mind, that the Bahamian people did not vote for, but it came in after this Free National Movement was elected. And so we've seen this consistent eroding and attacking of the Bahamian labor force, of which they're allowing non-Bahamians to come in and get jobs that Bahamians could get, and seeing the rise of our unemployment figures.
See, Obi, that's why this is a slippery slope of a conversation to have. Because your government last election, right? And I feel for you because you're the representative. At least the PLP got courage. I don't see many of the Free National Movement members out and about or the chairman really taking these answers, these questions, right? But your administration...
They can't defend the position. They can't defend the position.
Hold on, hold on, Obi, because I need you to defend this. Because when we talk immigration, I don't like these games, because this is real, right? For me, this is real, because Bahamian people are still struggling in their own country to make ends meet. Then mm-hmm. when we have laws that are being broken or people not living to the standard, we seem afraid to execute the laws on people who are breaking the law if they're not Bahamian, right? If they're not Bahamian. So here we have downtown, in the businesses downtown, how are so many of the diamond cutters, quote unquote, the jewelers, jewelry stores, are non-Bahamian? Is, I don't know what Arabic nation they coming from, right? We gave it a lot of permits for people who were supposed to be, you know, diamond cutters, but they're on the sales floor. Taking Bahamians out of bread and butter businesses, this happened under your administration. A lot of allegations of bringing in people, giving them status, giving them work permits, and then not living up to what is actually on their work permit. You'll play games with immigration as well. This ain't new. For me, this ain't new. And I think that once governments, leaders, parties need to be honest, you need to say, listen, yeah, some things have changed. If you're so different, Obi, if we're so different, we shouldn't be covering for this. We should be saying, listen, yeah, we did some things that were inappropriate. We did some things in immigration or in whatever area that needs to be fixed.
More enforcement.
We're better. Listen, just enforcement. Enforce y'all. Enforce the leaders in government. Enforce the prime minister. Enforce the immigration ministers. I'm just saying, look, I think you can't come to the Bahamian people trying to put this all on the Free National Movement. You just can't do it. I don't think you can. I actually appreciate that. What's his name? Minister. What's his name? Works guy.
That's what I'm saying.
I appreciate his strength in his words, but I don't like the words that he used.
Intonation and the verbiage, yeah, as well.
Yeah, and to make it seem as if all of Haiti is some sort of destitute land.
Definitely Mr. Barnes has been there, so he can attest to it, that as being factual. The whole place, I assume. The
whole place.
There's no nice place at all.
Well, we still letting folks in the bushes behind cow pen slash and burn everything, but we ain't concerned about that, eh? People, Bahamians been complaining for decades about that behavior. We still ain't resolved that. But and this is going through both parties. This is not just an FNM. All of a sudden, they fail us. This has been, Edison Key was who? What party Edison Key was a part of when he got them 400 work permits?
Well, it was his brother, not him. It was his brother. But also, he was a part of both parties. Both parties.
Don't try to switch it.
No, but Nahaja.
Don't switch it.
Nahaja. It is not all. It's all on Nahaja.
Now, I had your Roka, your former minister of immigration, at the same time on my show multiple times. He didn't say his brother. The minister of immigration never said his brother. The minister of education called his name and said he gave him 400 work permits. All right, thanks. Just so we could talk with Loftus Roka on that story. I mean, he's still alive to tell the tale. You know, but he's been on my show. I got recordings. He never mentioned Mr. Roka's brother. He did mention.
Not Roka, Key's brother.
Key's brother. Sorry.
I don't want him to come after me.
I don't want him to come after me. He's a strong man. But this is with immigration, we have to be fair. I think immigration is a sticky, a very sensitive topic.
Yes, it is. Mm-hmm.
And that matters to us that we get it right. We have to get it right. Stop playing games with immigration, man. Stop playing games with immigration. And the Progressive Liberal Party needs to say, if they're interested in this being one of their linchpins, you can't. I'm sorry, I don't feel right when you got you walking around in yellow shirt and talking about, you know, we can vote you in. Come, we for your party. Same thing, the Free National Movement last time. You'll be going to church and thing, get saved in Creole churches, and then forget the Creole churches after.
And clearly they remember. They say, voting them again. They remember.
We're going to take a quick break. We got to take a break. When we come back, we're going to continue our conversation here on The Hit Back with Nahaja Black, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. We'll be back after this.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Imagine. That's where every advancement begins, with an idea that things can be different, better. Now, imagine a world where your entertainment experience was all about you, your style, your show, at your budget. At Rev, that's what we've imagined. To join the conversation and learn more about the future of Rev TV, visit us at rev.bs/imagine.
Gran, it was good to see you, but we've got to get home.
Yep, we've got to let the dog out.
Speaking of dogs, you won't believe who I saw the other day.
Who?
Honey.
Remember Anton, Jeanette's oldest boy? The one with the dogs.
With local claims managers, we pay your motor claims fast. We're like a goodbye at your granny's that doesn't take 30 minutes.
We really got to get going.
So soon?
CG Atlantic Agents. Insurance, health, pensions, life. Good like that. Nassau Insurance Brokers and Agents Limited, trading as CG Atlantic Agents.
When I had got prostate cancer, my family didn't know if I was going to live. At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number. They see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. It's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
Preparing for a hurricane can make all the difference in safeguarding the lives of family, friends, and neighbors. By knowing what action you should take, you can reduce the effects of a hurricane disaster. Get all the facts of the potential of having insurance, impact-resistant windows, home emergency power, essential supplies, and a lot more before the storm. After the storm, where to purchase building or cleaning supplies, waste disposal, medical care, and more. The Nassau Guardians Hurricane Guide will help you make sure everyone knows what to do in the event a hurricane approaches. Take advantage of this double insertion opportunity plus 15 commercials on Star 106 hits. Contact us today at 302-2300. That's 302-2300 or your account executive. Will you be prepared?
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
We're back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. We're coming to the end of the show. But before we leave, I got to bring back my good friends, Obi Roberts and C.A. Nuri. It's good to have you guys on. As per usual, the show has been good so far. Obi, a lot of folks are saying we can't play politics with immigration. You've got to deal with it. It must be intentional. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people ain't buying what you're selling on that one. I just want you to know, as a good friend, I'm telling you, y'all got to switch that angle on blame the FNM, or the FNM is incompetent and y'all did so much thing. Anybody, people ain't feeling that one. However, and we should pivot. No, I'm running out of time. CA Nuri, my good friend here. Obi, I just, you know, throw that out there so y'all can work on y'all, whatever y'all gotta work on. And never mind. We can talk off the show on another point. Mm-hmm. Let's switch gears now. Last thing here, youth in politics. We got to switch gears. The debate that happened, and I wanted to get for sure CA's thoughts on the debate, right? Right, Baldy? And then Obi, I will say, I think your guy, he did well. He performed very well compared to the field, but it was a lot of bloviating as well. No massive new ideas. There's a lot of, but he delivered well. And I respect the fact that he was ready to deliver and debate his position, and he was on it. All right? Now, let's talk about the importance of youth in politics. CA, do you believe that we have a challenge bringing in the best and brightest into politics?
It is a tough question, you know. It's a tough question, and I don't know what to immediately say. I wanted to throw this name, Travis Robinson. Travis Robinson is definitely a youth.
I forgot about him.
Yes, who has participated and did well in Bahamian politics, and he is a mover and shaker in his own right. Then it is young Aubrey. Young Aubrey can be considered as young also, and maybe not really well, but good enough. He served his community. Everyone else other than them two, I consider as man and woman. I see they every so often they throw in Shenandoah Cartwright as a young politician, and he's older than I am. they throw in Adrian Gibson as a young politician. He too is older than I am. And you see how much gray I have on my face. So I think age and young is subjective. And I started off with Travis Robinson for a reason. There has yet to be any transition from a torch bearer or from a young liberal into mainstream politics at all. There's never been such. The either was a long time torchbearer, a long time young liberal, and they have became old and senior and then joined in the party, right? But it's never been said, I'm going to give that opportunity and mold you to give you opportunity to run. So then I look at the and I'm calling the PLP since OB here. If you look at the PLP's average age right now on who is running the platform, the average age there is about 60. 60. You know, you and I might even go up to 65 when you men and women. And I'm not gonna bash the PLP as the only one. The FNM party also average age is about 60 years old. And then you try to say they're trying to groom and bring forward young people. It's a farce. It's not true. They're lying to us.
Unless it's their children, they'll make it.
You know what I mean? But and they too are not frontline politics. They are support staff, right? So going back to the debate, I was happy to see young persons who are not politically aligned to the major parties participating, right? In whatever limited way. I was kind of frustrated at the how they weren't prepared for such mainstream debate and live about the issues. And that's something we would need to address, and what each party would need to address, that they need
to... The party needs to address that.
The party itself failed them, not the youth.
That's what it is. The party failed them.
And I see that you herald the PLP's candidate. I'm trying to remember his name. But,
I can't remember his name. He and the KGM young lad was good.
Justin Smith,
right?
And the KGM guy is Alexander.
And I remember a quote that a one-eyed man can be hailed as a king amongst the blind. Ooh. It wasn't that he did extremely well in it.
No.
It wasn't that he did extremely well. The field was just that poor.
The field was rough.
That he was able to shine. That he became a beacon of hope.
He was a great hope.
You know, even though he was just a male muster of light, right? Mm-hmm. A lighter in the dark sky, people were able to see it. But it wasn't that he was a big blazing fire. You said, "My Lord, look at that!" You know. But I give him credence that he was able to rehash general information about the PLP. It wasn't no policy that you could say, "Oh, I did not know that. I learned something just now. That's something I need to go and follow the PLP on. I was inspired. I need to do things that support them." I did not get that, but I won't criticize him. And then when you look at each of the candidates, clearly, I mean, the KGM or the Kingdom government, he had one or two good points. Mm-hmm. But I want to commend all of the persons who were for it there. I enjoyed the debate. I think there's a lot of possibilities with it. I'm eager to see more debates because of it. And this is just the first one. So I'm not going to critique them harshly for it. It's just that there's a need for political parties to prepare their youth arm to make sure they are aware of the issues and have the issues pertaining to youth. And this is where I criticize also critiquing the organizers. The question should have been geared towards what is the youth doing instead of these broad topics that senior parliamentarians would have issues answering. You don't do that to persons who are novice in the field and who are representing. They should have come use specific questions that they can put more meat on and answer. Well, because it's a pertaining to me, this is how I'm going to answer to it.
Nahaja, first and foremost, I want to correct my good friend CA on the age of many of our candidates in terms of being obviously 60 or older. Besides our leader, our chairman, also the candidate in Englandston and also in Fort Charlotte, the majority of our candidates are either in their late 40s, early 50s.
Call three names.
What you mean?
Any three names you want to call in the name.
Chester Cooper is 51. Michael Akitas is 51. You want me to go further than that?
Yes, I want three names.
All right, Marcus Roll is 51.
Don't call no woman age on the show.
Oh, like, Leslie, you want to go to Joe Beth, who's not 40 as yet?
They're young.
Senator Clay Sweeting is also in his mid-30s. But come on now.
He's talking about some of these people on this one here.
No. Yeah. In terms of that right now.
That there is 68. That average age right there is 68.
No, and so that picture there defines all of the candidates. Come on now. Don't mislead the
public. Alfred says.
All right. But we have 39 or 38 candidates thus far. But I want to say, okay, Nahaja.
Yeah.
The PLP is always welcome. Young, prospective faces. But persons are looking at persons that are coming at age of 21. We look at one's ability, not one's age. Because that can hamper you at 20 or that can hamper you whether you're at 65. We look at the talent and your ability to contribute to national development. We encourage that. And we embrace that within the Progressive Party. Many things in our past have seen great leadership that come from members who came from our Progressive Young Liberals over the years. All right. And we continue to force that and encourage that. Remember now, it was us who came to the forefront and accepted the debate, the Free National Movement. You had not one person, not even from their youth development, not even from their cabinet and senior level one to enter the debate because they have nothing to defend. All of their accomplishments, in the last 4 years, what have they accomplished? They right now trying to push out stuff right now to the Bahamian public to give some impression that they have accomplished something over the past 4 years. Mm-hmm. But the Bahamian people are already fed up and done with this particular government. And they've been fed false promises, a lot of lies and a lot of misleading stuff right now in terms of all this goes back to the quote, the people's time. But when you hear Dr. Menace gets up in the House of Assembly, and it shocked me, to say the next time, if given the opportunity, that he will pay more attention to the poor people. When it was the poor people who voted him in large numbers, gave him a 35-4 differential in victory. And these last 4 years, you never paid it any mind, but we saw through his policies, he wasn't concerned with the average Bahamian. We saw it through his legislature that he dealt with his special interest group. And I was like a slap into the face of many Bahamians right now who bought and accepted the word of Dr. Menace and many of his colleagues in the Free National Movement.
We have to do this. I want you to be ready for this. We'll be doing more of this, getting my panel together as we go through this political season.
Guys,
thank you so much. We're plumb out of time. It's amazing how time flies. And I started late with y'all anyway, so forgive me. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. I want to thank both my co-hosts today, C.A. Nuri, Obi Roberts. Everyone be safe. My head killing me. So glad it's 6 o'clock. Talk to y'all later. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Guardian Radio, we're out.